Hi everyone, I welcome you all for this Nursing Wisdom channel. Today we are going to see about shoulder dystocia. Definition: the term shoulder dystocia describes failure of the shoulder to traverse the pelvis spontaneously, requiring additional maneuvers after the birth of the head. Incidence: overall incidence varies between 0.2 and 1%. Risk factors: during pre-labor, short in nature, small or abnormal pelvis, more than 42 weeks gestation, maternal diabetes and gestational diabetes, postterm pregnancy, high parity, maternal age over 35 years, maternal obesity, fetal macrosomia, that means baby weight over 4000 gram, anencephaly, fetal ascites, previous shoulder dystocia. During intrapartum, the risk factors include oxytocin augmentation, prolonged labor, prolonged first stage of labor, secondary arrest, prolonged second stage of labor, operative labor includes Vendos and forceps delivery. Warning signs: the birth may have been uncomplicated initially, but the head may have advanced slowly, with the chin having difficulty in sweeping over the perineum. The turtle sign: definite recoil of the head back against the perineum. That means once the head is born, it may look as it is trying to return into the vagina. Inadequate spontaneous restitution. Diagnosis of shoulder dystocia. Shoulder dystocia is diagnosed when maneuvers such as gentle downward axial traction on the head that may normally be used by the midwife fail to complete the birth. Management principle: there is some do's and don'ts for the management. Don'ts: do not be panicky, do not encourage further pushing, do not give traction over baby's head, do not apply fundal pressure. Why we should not apply fundal pressure means it causes further impaction of the shoulder. Moreover, it causes neurologic and orthopedic damage. Do's: what are the things we have to do? First, call for extra help. The midwife coordinator, an experienced obstetrician, an anesthetist, and a person proficient in neonatal resuscitation. Stating the problem early to the team has been associated with improvements in outcomes in shoulder dystocia. Next, clear the infant's mouth and nose. The head already delivered, so we have to clear the infant's mouth and nose. Perform a wide mediolateral episiotomy if not made earlier. Next, first line maneuvers. First maneuver is MC Robert maneuver. This maneuver involves assisting the woman to lie completely flat. Fellow has to remove with her buttocks at the edge of the bed and hyperflexing her hips to bring her knees up to her chest as far as possible. This maneuver will rotate the angle of the symbiosis pubis superiorly and is the weight of the woman's leg to create gentle pressure on her abdomen, releasing the impaction of the anterior shoulder. The MC Roberts maneuver is associated with the lowest level of morbidity and requires the least to assist the birth. Next, suprapubic pressure. Pressure should be exerted on the side of the fetal back and towards the fetal chest. This maneuver may help to adduct the shoulders and push the anterior shoulder away from the symbiosis pubis into the larger oblique or transverse diameter. Suprapubic pressure can be employed together with the MC Roberts maneuver to improve success rate. If you diagnosed as shoulder dystocia, immediately place the mother in MC Robert maneuver position and will start to give suprapubic pressure. These two maneuver we will perform together. Mostly by performing this first line maneuver, we will succeed and we will deliver the baby. If we fail only, we will go for attempting second line maneuver. episiotomy, the problem facing the midwife is an obstruction at the pelvic inlet, which is a bony dystocia, not an obstruction caused by soft tissue. Although episiotomy will not help to release the shoulders, the midwife should consider the need to perform one to gain access to the fetus without tearing the perineum and vaginal walls. Episiotomy we will not perform routinely for all the patient except primary. Here first line maneuver we can apply without performing episiotomy for multiparous mother because head already delivered. But before to perform second line maneuver we must perform episiotomy because we are going to insert our hand and going to perform maneuver. So we need more space. Here episiotomy will help to get adequate space to perform the maneuver and protect the perineum from perineal tears. Second line maneuvers, it is otherwise called as rotational maneuvers. First maneuver is the Rubin's maneuver. Rubin advocated this maneuver in 1964. It is performed by placing a hand into the vagina, applying pressure to the posterior aspect of the most accessible fetal shoulder towards the fetal chest. This will lead to adduction of the fetal shoulder, which would then allow the anterior shoulder to rotate and deliver from behind the pubic bone where it is impacted. Here we will insert the hand through vagina and find posterior shoulder, then apply pressure in posterior shoulder towards chest. This will cause adduction of fetal shoulder that will create the space so impacted anterior shoulder rotate and deliver behind pubic bone. Next maneuver, delivery of the posterior arm. The obstetrician slide a hand along the fetal posterior shoulder and arm, and the fetal forearm or wrist grasped and swept across the anterior fetal chest to effect delivery of the posterior arm. If the fetal forearm is not easily accessible, one can follow the posterior fetal arm and put pressure on the antecubital fossa, and this will typically lead to flexion of the fetal arm, allowing access to the fetal forearm. With successful delivery of the posterior arm, the axilloacromial diameter becomes the presenting part and it is typically about 3 cm shorted and lead to delivery of the anterior shoulder. Here we will insert our hand through vagina and deliver posterior arm. After delivery of the posterior shoulder, the axilloacromial diameter becomes presenting part. This is 3 cm shorter than previous diameter, so this will help in delivery of impacted anterior shoulder. Next maneuver is the Wood's corkscrew maneuver. The obstetrician places a hand on the anterior aspect of the posterior shoulder and rotates the shoulder towards the fetal back. The goal is to attempt to rotate the fetal shoulder 180 degrees angle. This allows the fetus to descend while the rotation is occurring. Here, the obstetrician inserts hand through vagina and hold posterior shoulder, then rotate the fetus to 180 degree angle toward fetal back. While rotating, this will allow the fetus to descend and relieve impaction and help in delivery of baby. Next, Gaskin maneuver. With the patient on her four hands and knees, all four position or in a racing start or sprinter position. Here gentle downward traction is applied to the posterior shoulder, that means the shoulder against the maternal sacrum, or upper traction is applied on the anterior shoulder, that means the shoulder against the maternal symbiosis. This will aid in delivery of fetus. Next, Mendicoglio maneuver. The obstetrician places their middle fingers under the posterior fetal axilla and applies downward and outward traction, which leads to delivery of the posterior shoulder. This is then followed by delivery of the posterior arm. Next maneuver, posterior axilla sling traction. A suction catheter or femurinary catheter is used as a sling Traction is applied to the sling to deliver the posterior shoulder followed by the arm. Alternatively, the sling can be used to rotate the shoulders by applying lateral traction towards the baby's back while the other hand is placed on the anterior shoulder, putting pressure towards the fetal chest. Next, heroic muscles. First one is intentional clavicular fracture. The fetal clavicle is intentionally fractured by pulling the anterior clavicle outward. If successful, this will decrease the bisacromial diameter. Disadvantages: difficult to execute, the possibility of injury to underlying vascular and pulmonary structures. Next, cleidotomy. One or both clavicles may be cut with scissors to reduce the shoulder girth. This is applicable to a living anencephalic baby as a first choice or in a dead fetus. Symbiosiotomy is the surgical separation of the symbiosis pubis and is used to enlarge the pelvis to enable the birth. It is usually performed in cases of cephalopelvic disproportion and is used more routinely in the developing country. There are a few recorded cases where symbiosiotomy has been used associated with a high level of maternal morbidity. Next, Savanelli maneuver. In this maneuver, the fetus head is flexed and the fetus is replaced within the uterus. Thereafter, baby is delivered by emergency cesarean section. This maneuver is not generally practiced. Helper mnemonic device to provide a systematic approach to the management of shoulder dystocia. Here, H for help, E for episiotomy need assist, L for legs in MC Roberts position, P for pressure suprapubically, E for enter vagina, that means internal rotation, R for remove posterior arm, another R for roll the woman over and try again, that means all four position. Next, outcomes following shoulder dystocia: fetal hazards, fetal aspasia, injury to the brachial plexus, damage to cervical nerve roots 5 and 6 may result in an Abe's palsy, fracture humerus and clavicle or sternomastoid hematoma during delivery, perinatal mortality and morbidity. Maternal hazards includes increased operative delivery, maternal morbidity, maternal death from uterine rupture has been reported following the use of fundal pressure, hemorrhage during and following the birth. Approximately 2/3 of women will have blood loss of more than 1000 ml from injury associated with the birth. Serious tearing of the perineum, that means 3rd degree and 4th degree perineal tear. Prevention: prediction of shoulder dystocia is not possible accurately, so care is to be taken to reduce the time internal delivery of the head to that of the body. I hope you got understand about the shoulder dystocia and its management. Thanks for watching.